Hello and welcome to the National Security Conversations. Today we will discuss Arihant and the state of India's nuclear deterrence. Early November this year, India announced that its ship submersible ballistic nuclear submarine SSBN, the INS Arihant, completed its first deterrent patrol. Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, tweeted on the occasion, India's pride nuclear submarine INS Arihant successfully completed its first deterrence patrol. What does it mean? A nuclear triad would have a sea-based leg, an air-based leg, and a land-based leg. At this point of time, we have both the land-based leg and the air-based leg. So INS Arihant takes India closer to the third leg of actualizing its sea-based leg. However, there are a lot of questions about the robustness of India's sea deterrence, its command and control issues, and the challenges of sea deterrence. So to discuss these issues and more, I have with me in the studio Admiral, Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha. Vice Admiral Sinha is a former chief of India's Integrated Defence Staff. He retired in 2014. As the Commander-in-Chief of the Western Naval Command based in Mumbai. Welcome to the National Security Conversation, Admiral Sinha.
Thank you, Dr. Jacob.
Admiral, let me begin by asking about the significance of Arihant. What is the significance of INS Arihant going on deterrent patrol? What does it mean for India's nuclear deterrence, as it were?
The main meaning of this is that the nuclear submarine was armed with full quota of its ballistic missiles, and it was deployed in a place from where its missile could attack, if required, major economic targets, which includes the cities, because as a second strike. And therefore, it's a big big sort of news, and it's something which is, it should deter other countries to use the nuclear weapon to start with, because we have a policy of no first use.
That's correct.
So if we have a policy of no first use and somebody has hit you, and if they have hit on the land-based silos or land-based nucleus, the assets wherever they are deployed, or the airfields from where the aircraft will be taking off with the air launch, whereas at sea you cannot find out as to where is the submarine. He could be anywhere in the Indian Ocean, which is at the closest point it is 1500 nautical miles, 750 on either side of east and west coast. So I think it's a great deterrence, which I think can increase the safety factor and prevent the first use of the nuclear weapon.
Admiral, what are the key drivers of this SSBN program? In other words, why do we need an SSBN program?
It goes back into a little bit of history, because it started quite some time back. In 1974, we did our first actually nuclear weapon small sort of explosion.
I'm happy you said that. In 1974, yes. It was the first, yes. Nuclear.
So what happened was, after the 71 war, which very decisively India sort of led, the Chinese began to start deploying their nuclear weapons closer to the Indian borders. Earlier they were in further north.
Right.
And it became a little bit of worry for the Indian government. And Indian government sort of wanted to make sure that we are protected at every cost. And then the nuclear weapon program started. Then it was a quite open acceptance during Prime Minister Bajpayee's time that, we have gone nuclear. And that was really of the nuclear weapon, and not only the nuclear explosion. It just proved that we have made the nuclear weapon. We are a nuclear powered country. And of course, we went through a whole lot of sanctions, etc., etc. But it is required, because if you have two neighbors And if they keep threatening, particularly our neighbor on the west, very often they would rant that, you know, we can use nuclear weapon, India can use any conventional weapon. Their ministers, their other people, except for the military probably. But knowing fully well that the nuclear weapon in Pakistan is not controlled by the, you know, the political hierarchy. They don't have any access. It is the military. So, worry in India was, at least in the military establishment, that here the military is completely under the control of the political masters. And nuclear weapons must be used as a political weapon. It's not a military weapon. But here is a country where it is a military weapon. So, therefore, the command and control is by the military, the same military, who is actually fighting another military on the borders.
Right.
So, therefore, I think that from that point of view, it became necessary for us to have a nuclear weapon and also the ability to hit back. And once we declared ourselves as a nuclear weapon state, very thought out a statement was made by then Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee that we will not be the first ones to use the nuclear weapon, but we will respond very heavily as a second strike capability. And since then, the second strike nuclear weapon program has been very active.
But Admiral, how far advanced are we in this game of sea deterrence? How robust is India's SSBN program? The reason I'm asking this is because for example, the missiles, the ICBMs in the Arihant submarine, were they nuclear tipped? What is, if they were not nuclear tipped, what is the difference between an SSBN and an SSN, except for the size, of course? So the question that I'm trying to ask is that are we still very early in the game, or are we sort of somewhat advanced in this sort of nuclear deterrence at sea game?
You mentioned about, you know, the nuclear weapons being over land and over air dropped. We had a sea-based nuclear device, but fitted on a ship.
That's correct.
We have 2-3 ships where the Project Dhanush was made, and the missile ranges were keeping within the missile control regime, MTCR, and it had a range of roughly 300 kilometers. But that could be nuclear tipped because we are, you know, the integrated missile development program was going on. As far as your question is concerned, very specifically, India's nuclear missiles are in operational state ranging from 750 to 3000 kilometers.
That's correct.
Right? So, any of these missiles could be put on the Arihant. Let us say, for example, that we are going by step. Obviously, there is a lot of room for improvement. And I think that, you know, our days are not far, because Agni 5, which is the 5000 miles range, 5000 kilometers range, that sea-based submerged trials have already been done. So, very recently, they said that we have carried out, you know, now it is going to be, and in fact, it was fired by the Strategic Force Command, which is the user. So, I think that, you know, days are not far, but for that to be fitted, at least the 5000 kilometer range, it requires a slightly bigger silo, because you will appreciate that the propellant size will have to be much bigger. It has to go very long distance.
Okay.
So, the silos will be bigger, meaning that the perimeter, the circumference of the submarine will be much more, not this 6000 tons which Arihant is riding.
So, at the moment we are talking about K-15 missiles, but we should ideally have K-4 missiles of 3500 kilometers to reach either Pakistan or China for that matter. What about, more importantly, if you have to have continuous sort of patrol in the sea, you need to have more than one, and you need to have at least four. How far have we reached in that sort of number game?
As far as I can see, you have two very specific points that possibly you are hinting at. The first is that how far it can reach. Now, this is the advantage with a mobile platform. A submarine, without you knowing, it can be positioned at a distance from where it can hit the targets that you want to hit. on both sides of our border. If you position it further north in Bay of Bengal, you can reach many parts of China.
Right.
Surely Kunming, which is a very big hub of business. And in the western Indian Ocean, the Western Arabian Sea, it can reach anywhere. Even if you start with 750 kilometers, if you park it close enough, you will find that you can reach reasonably up to the northern end of their border.
Depending on what kind of missile you have in the submarine.
That's right. Even if you have, say, the lesser range variety, it would still hit those countries. But what you want is, you don't want to be sitting too close. Because what happened that in both cases, you will be in a slightly shallower water. If you are in shallow water, then your detection becomes that much easier. And nuclear submarines make a lot of noise because the speed is very high. The hydrological noise is quite a lot. If it's something is moving and tearing the water at 25 knots, obviously the ambient noise is going to be quite high. So acoustics will be, you know, acoustics will give away the position. Whereas, you know, the submarine must be at a distance from where you can fire. And it should be submerged so that your location, even if it gets compromised after it has launched the missile, it can get out of this area and you wouldn't know where is he gone.
What is the objective?
Objective would be because if you see these two countries, they have the capability of hitting you in your business centers in western coast, all our scientific establishments. Which are, you know, located rightly in the right from the beginning in the south, your big industries, and therefore, you know, they might just hit something which is required to do the second strike from land or air. I don't know what is their plan. Otherwise, he wouldn't be making 5,000 kilometer range missile and positioning it in Tibetan plateau. What else can be the reason? It can't be firing at sea.
Yeah.
So, the bigger range missiles are required for primarily the economic targets, and bigger cities are always economic targets, associated to some business, some industry or something like that. It depending upon how badly we have been hit. So, we should not be looking for answers when we have already been hit, because for all you know, our main command and control center may be under threat. So, we have to have a credible alternate for that as well.
What about the numbers? We have now one nuclear submarine, Arihant. How many more are we planning and how many more are required for continuous sea deterrence? One is probably certainly not good enough.
You mentioned that, you know, at least four. You mentioned yourself.
Yeah.
I would say if you have to keep four at sea, which is a reasonable number, and you have to keep sort of changing their places, then you require six, seven of them. You know, so that, you know, one can be in the harbor or it can be at any other location. You see, in the nuclear submarine, the limitation is human endurance, Dr. Jacob.
Hmm.
It is not the, it can remain on petrol indefinitely. Till such time, the fuel core or the rods, they become due for a change or some kind of, you know, the reactor becomes due for some kind of maintenance. Otherwise, you can just carry on.
Oh, that's interesting. So, there are no technical constraints on keeping the submarines in the
sea? Not really. It is just the human endurance. Technically, there is no, I mean, the chain reaction will carry on. It will keep propelling the nuclear device, a nuclear propulsion. But what you have is the nuclear missiles which are in the submarine. Obviously, they are, you know, they may be having fewer interlocks for launch. So, it means it is active.
That's right.
So, you know, for that, there must be some time frame. There must be some limitation of time. That could be reason, but that can be you know, taken care by replacing it by another submarine with the similar type of missile arrangement. But that is why you require a slightly longer range missile so that you don't have to worry about these things.
Admiral, my next question is about what kind of deterrence is India planning? Is it sort of a bastion control sort of deterrence, or is it continuous at sea at all points of time in sort of longer range locations? What kind of deterrence is India planning?
I would think that it's only when the, you know, the war of clouds, as they say, or the clouds of war are hanging around you, that you will start going into some kind of preparatory phase. So, if the tensions are high on the land border, or there is a sufficient, it has to be backing a land war. it must back a land war. You know, you can't, because, there is an escalation ladder. So you start with conventional fight, small skirmish. Suppose the talks fail and it continues to increase, and there are chances of any of the parties losing some territory, which will be unacceptable. And a time will come when the conventional war would have reached its own limit, because either of the countries are not able to protect the territorial integrity, what they think is the territory. So if the territorial integrity is threatened, then the country which is being threatened, and we have said that we will not use the nuclear weapon. So obviously we expect that our conventional war fighting machine is good enough to protect our territorial integrity, whether it is on land or our airspace or maybe our sea area, EEZ, possibly. But if, then what will happen, that we will probably go into all out conventional war, because if it gets threatened. If we go into all out conventional war, I am very certain that it will be at the cost of loss of territory to the other parties. We have only two countries to deal with, and it will be a loss of their territory, which can provoke a nuclear war. They are using the nuclear weapon first, and we have said that if you use nuclear weapon, my response will be absolutely devastating. It will really. Indian Prime Minister had made a statement in the parliament. Somebody asked that, so and so country is making. Yeah, he said, tactical nuclear weapon. He said, if the Indian troops, no matter which territory they are in, Indian ship or Indian territory, any of these get threatened or any of them get hit by nuclear weapon, the retaliation will be massive.
But do you think that's a practical way of approaching this? Is massive retaliation credible at all?
I think that it has worked so far. Are the fact that the strategy worked, so the threat of massive retaliation, now you got the triad, the third leg, the subsurface ballistic missile.
You mentioned in your previous answer that the job of the nuclear, the sea leg of the nuclear deterrent, is to support a land war. But I imagined the sea deterrent to be in order to sort of beef up the second strike capability, that it is sort of placed deep in the ocean so that it is not detected, it is not found by the adversary. So in case all your other systems fail, the land-based and the air-based nuclear systems, deterrent systems fail, then this one comes into sort of operation. So would I be right in saying that this is probably not necessarily in assisting the land war, but when the land and air component of your nuclear deterrence fail, this comes into play. Would I be right in saying that?
Dr. Shekhar, no, you have a point. You have a very good point. But look at this. When an adversary hits you with a nuclear weapon, where will he be hitting? It will be on land. Right. And I said that it must be preceded by a proper land war. Because, if somebody wants to gain, he wants to push you out from his territory, or his territorial integrity is now doubtful, he is not able to maintain, then he would like to do such a damage that your back should get broken. And that will happen if you damage some big city, or you damage some very big establishments, atomic energy plants and things like that, or maybe your launch sites, the position of which is compromised from day one. So I would say that my sense is that the nuclear fight, and in fact it's a good thing that we have only second strike, we have no first use, because we know that I will react only if my land gets hit, where people have died, or some very heavy economic damage has taken place, which can become unbearable for us to recover in so many years, then I will not even wait for my land-based assets. I may just like to react, because it's a political weapon. It depends on what the politician wants. In our case, it is not a military sort of weapon, completely under political control. And he has to be given an order. There are people who in the chain, two, three layers of political. The services only launch it. Strategic Force Command, which is the holder, keeper of this assets, he is only going on an order which has gone through filtration of the political masters of this.
Right. I mean, going along that point, let me ask you a slightly different question, which is, if the objective of India's nuclear deterrent capability is to ensure that its second strike capability is strengthened, so at some point of time in future, we may not even need the air leg and the land leg. We'd only need a very robust 5 or 6 SSBNs deep in the sea, because it's only second strike capability that you require. You don't need in that sense. Like, I mean, some other countries have practiced this. It's not as if I'm sort of saying it out of thin air. So, would you in future foresee a possibility where you could even think of discarding the air leg and the land leg and invest heavily in the naval leg?
Theoretically, yes. Theoretically, you are right that if you have such robust fleet of nuclear submarines and the SSBNs and SSNs, then you may not need so many assets. But you know, creating so many submarines, making so many submarines is a very expensive business. And therefore, the government will have to weigh, very judiciously as to how much of land based assets we want to have. How much of, for example, right now we have only one asset. Second one is about to be commissioned, Arihant. So what will happen is that in the meantime, you got these assets where you can respond. You have a second strike capability. So this second strike capability, which they already have, it is quite possible that their growth rate could become less because you are having more and more. But making so many submarines is a very, very expensive business. But I would think that the political masters and those in the chain of doing the decision making of what should be our holding, they would weigh this very, very, very cautiously, and therefore it's a very important question. What will be the balance between the sea-based assets, subsurface assets, land-based assets? Because the fact is that if you have been hit once, then the nuclear war has commenced. And there is possibility that you have been hit in such a place from where we are not able to launch our air assets.
Absolutely.
Because the nuclear, contaminated clouds would have been in the atmosphere for a long time.
Well, command and control may have gone down.
Command and control may have gone down. So, you are only left with the standby system. So, with the standby system, they will positively have a mix of the shorter range, longer range, because if you want to hit something close by, then you may not like to use a very long range weapon for everything. So it has to be a combination. It has to be a combination of some land based, but mobile. You got to have the, as you know, that the nuclear weapons are completely under the control of the scientific community. And all the portions are at different places. This is to ensure that the chain, everybody puts his, the decision making body as to, okay, you want this, we'll give you this, but this can be the end result.
But that's the problem when it comes to the sea leg, isn't it? Because if you have canisterized missiles, they need to be, if not properly mated, at least at a sort of fair distance where it could potentially be mated. If, say, for example, if Arihant is on a deterrence patrol and if it has K-15 canisterized on board, then you can't have bark having control of, say, for example, the nuclear warhead. It will have to be in that in the platform itself.
No, absolutely right. And therefore, what is the alternate? What does the world strategic forces do? What they do is they have more number of electronic interlocks, so that when the order finally comes, after all, he's receiving order. The captain is not free to fire on his own. There is a antenna which is trailed, either for a communication satellite based, or it is possibly some other trail antennas which will receive the either a coded form of message or a plain language message if it is our own satellite. So once it gets the message right, and there must be some method of challenging, in the sense that captain should be very sure that yes, I have been told to launch. So that is when he has got certain codes which he will throw back, that so and so part of the nuclear command chain, you think it's time for us to launch. So these are interlocks. Let us say that I have to get a, you know, suppose you are the political master and you have ordered that, okay, Sinha, you launch the missile. What will happen is that I am hiding somewhere. I am down below. I have only got a message. Now, how do we make sure that we don't do miscalculation? Mm-hmm. There has to be some reply and response mechanism. So, what I will do is, let's say you have passed the message, you are at the peak. And there is another party which is actually in the chain who has helped you make this decision. So, another way to check is that here, who is sitting at sea, I just respond back or query back to him saying that, you know, is it time, shall I launch it now? So, that chain has gone through properly and everybody in the chain has agreed, everybody in the chain has decided for using the political weapon, there is a bit of confirmation.
But Admiral Sinha, this is easier said than done, isn't it? Because the unless and until your submarine is sort of based in the shallow waters, in the sort of in your vicinity, the command and control is going to be difficult, because even the PLA Navy has not sort of mastered the command and control sort of systems. So when it comes to the rudimentary command and control systems that we may have at this point of time, are we talking about positive controls or are we talking about negative controls? Are we talking about the permissive action links? What are we really talking about here? I mean, without of course giving out the any details that you might not want to, but I mean, what are we really talking about in terms of the command and control?
No, I think it's a very valid sort of query. One has to be inquisitive to find out. And therefore, we will assume that these questions have been, must have been discussed.
Right.
And they are discussed, obviously. Questions are thrown. What will happen? Now, the point is that, do I have to stay close? I would say that technology has gone beyond that. You know, we have our submarines which are operating far off and we are in dialogue. How do you think China deployed a nuclear submarine in Indian Ocean in 2014? Mm. It deployed here and he was in contact. He was in contact with some intermediary, platform, which was passed the message. His responsibility was only to talk to this entity. So that is the technological advancements that we have made, and why it is important. I'll come back to the first one. Why it is important to say all this? That is because, for the first time, we have a very credible system where you can deploy your submarine and still give him the order, no matter where is he in this Indian Ocean, and tell him that you can launch now. So, it's not that we are not able to talk, we are able to talk. The technology has advanced and we have reached those places where the command and control system has been tried out. That is why he is on an actual deterrent patrol.
Admiral, correct me if I am wrong, but let me sort of put it this way. There are two things. One, the captain of the ship will not be able to launch the nuclear missile and it will not be pre-delegated. He will not be able to launch the nuclear missile without specific authorization from the nuclear command authority. And secondly, no matter where the ship is, no matter where the submarine is, say even 1,300 nautical miles away from the land, deep in the Indian Ocean, he will be able to receive messages from the dedicated nuclear station on land and will be able to carry out the attack, even though, and assuming that, a nuclear attack has first taken place against India, because India is in second strike capability. Would I be right in assuming that?
Well, yes and no. I'll tell you why I say yes and no. The point is that the nuclear wars don't happen all of a sudden. As I said, that it will be preceded by a land war, conventional war, air war, escalation ladder. So it has reached a stage where the command and control authorities would have cautioned all their assets that you may be used. So what you have done is you have in the preparation ladder, probably you have reduced some steps, because if that order comes from the highest body in the country, political master, then they know that when he says this, I have to be so much prepared. So you have reduced the time of reaction. Second thing is that, you know, once you are hit by nuclear weapon, you will be faced with two, three problems. One is that is an emergency at home.
Right.
the government will be really busy fighting those things. And secondly, the response. The response has to be very calibrated. Because now that we have said that the retaliation will be absolutely devastating. We have said so. So the government will not say that he has fired a nuclear weapon, fire it now. It's not going to happen like this. The nuclear weapon will be launched very deliberately. And therefore that gives that much of time to get that readiness to a level where he is only told launch. Get my point? So, whether it's 1500 miles or it's 700 miles or 800 miles, it will much will depend on the targets being selected in the adversary's country. What do you want to hit if you want to do a devastating damage? And secondly, that is the missile range. And secondly, during this process, the communication linkages would have been made such that the least amount of time is required between the order of launch and him to launch.
All right. Admiral, several people make the argument that nuclear weapons going to sea now will have negative implications for regional stability, especially during a period when India and Pakistan do not talk to each other on nuclear issues, and India and China do not have a nuclear dialogue at all. So do you think, very quickly, that there are negative implications for regional stability?
My very personal opinion, no. Actually, it actually increases the chance of stability and peace much more.
Provided the others also have the similar capability.
They will. You see, the point is that a lot of people think that, you know, we are not talking to each other. The one talk which has not stopped is the CBM for nuclear weapons. We have a nuclear CBM with Pakistan. We have our all nuclear facilities, they are known to each other, and that is renewed every year. Yeah. So that talk is very, very good talk. Even the chance encounters at sea, we have a CBM with Pakistan for many years.
Also, Admiral, I thought we still do not have an incidence at sea sort of CBM like the Cold War rival used to have, the Americans and Soviets. Given the fact that a lot of feverish developments taking place in the Indian Ocean region, the Chinese coming in on patrol, the Pakistan is developing, and the relationship between China and Pakistan, I thought it is important to have that incidence at sea, especially if Pakistan is used dual use platforms and you can't identify what they are using it for, misunderstanding, etc. So I thought we don't have an incidence at sea.
With Pakistan, we have a chance encounter or incident reporting mechanism. And where it is laid down as to how close can the two ships or two submarines on surface or ship or a submarine on surface can come close to each other.
Right.
And they are cautioned and warned, and if those things are violated, there is a proper method of a political and a diplomatic protest, and it is resolved. It is working. Unless, the war clouds are so close that you might as well do an infringement rather than maintaining a very cautious approach. With China, we need to do this now, because China, the chances of encounter at sea, accidental encounter and unintended sort of provocation, unprovoked firing, that was not a reality at one time. But now it is a reality in Indian Ocean. So that is why I say that, our strategic maneuvering space in the Indian Ocean is going to become more challenging with the Chinese arrival in the Indian Ocean. We need to have this talk. In fact, it will happen. Maritime cooperation, when Prime Minister Modi went to China for the first time in 2015, at the MOU which was signed, one of the bullet points was the maritime cooperation. And if you see the second or third round of talk, it's a work in progress. Work has commenced. And if you see the Chinese military strategy paper of 2015, which was released on 27th of May, you will see, you must read that document very carefully. There he talks about that China desires to become a world maritime power, because the thought that the having power on continent on the land is all pervasive must be abandoned. Because if progress, prosperity of humankind or the Chinese people has to be ensured, then China must build its maritime power. And now their navy has become a strategic force. from near sea it has gone distant sea. So what he is saying, and he says that cooperate with the countries. Now which countries will he cooperate? India is the biggest country to cooperate, because this is where he is very vulnerable. People keep talking that, you know, he is making pipelines, this, that. Our study is very clear, he can make any number of pipelines. It will only give him 27% relief. His balance, the 63%, will still be overseas and through the Indian Ocean, whether he comes from America, he comes from Africa, he comes from Gulf, wherever he comes from. He has to cross that Malacca Strait. It does not give him the liberty of being completely. And that is why the Basin Djibouti, or let's say some agreement with Sri Lanka, if it happens, though so far it has not happened, Gwadar, all that will happen. But let's not forget that more number of bases you create away from home, you are also creating so many targets.
Admiral, wonderful talking to you.
Thank you, Dr. Jacob. It was very, very interesting talk.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.